Peter G is going to serve as our moderator for this panel, and he's from Asian American for Equality and also a partner member from Project Charge, which many of us are involved in. So, and you probably will hear more about Project Charge and other issues that they have been working on.
Good morning. I'm really excited about being here today. My name is Peter G, and I work at Asian Americans for Equality. We're a comprehensive community development organization based here in New York City, and we're proud members of Project Charge. I'm really honored to be moderating this panel and a little humbled just because there's a lot of experts here, and they're really amazing folks. And so just thank you to the folks who are coordinating today's conference, the Center for the Study for Asian American Health, Charles B. Wang, Ari, and all the other sponsoring organizations. For almost a century, presidents and members of Congress have attempted and failed to provide universal health benefits to Americans. And on March 30th, 2010, after a year of intense debate between Republicans and Democrats and advocacy from all parts of the political spectrum, President Obama signed into law the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, legislation that will make remake this nation's healthcare system. Healthcare reform obviously has a large impact on the Asian Pacific American community, and we put a panel here together today to begin to summarize what that impact will be on our community, who was left out of the reform, how folks in our New York City have been organizing around these issues, and what will implementation look like. You know, I think a lot of folks are like, well, today's a conference about Asian American women. What does healthcare reform have to do with that? And you know, just talking with some of the panelists, it has an obvious impact on all of us, including Asian American women, especially since Asian American women are such gatekeepers in a lot of our families. And so this panel is extremely relevant. I just wanted to introduce the panel very quickly. To my left, we have the amazing Regina Lee. She is a Chief Development Officer at the Charles B. Wang Community Health Center. Regina is one of the co-founders of the center and is a member of the Executive Committee. And then to Regina's left is Noylan Abisamis Mendoza, the Manager of Health Policy for the Coalition for Asian American Children and Families. Noylan leads the health advocacy project to improve language access, cultural competence, and healthcare affordability. Among her major responsibilities is Project Charge, the Coalition for Health Access to Reach Greater Equity, a pan-Asian network of over 14 partners aiming to expand financial access to healthcare. And to Noylan's left, we have Adam Gurevich. He's a health policy specialist at the National Immigration Law Center, and Adam focuses on policies and advocacy to preserve and expand immigrants' access to health care and insurance. So after folks are going to be making some brief remarks, we're going to have question and answers. And so I want people to just, you know, we want to have a robust Q&A period. So folks should take their time right now to think of some pressing questions that they have, and whatever question that doesn't get answered in the brief remarks that folks will be giving, we want you to ask those questions right after that. We're going to start off with Noylan. So I'm going to ask Noylan to just summarize the health impact, the impact of healthcare reform on the Asian Pacific American community by providing some overview of the benefits and what it did not cover, and how the APA community in New York City mobilized around this issue. Let's give a loud round of applause for Noylan.
So I will say, when I was standing in the back, it was a little bit hard to hear. So if you can't hear me in the back, just let me know and I can certainly speak up a lot louder. Again, my name is Noylan Abisamis Mendoza. I'm with the Coalition for Asian American Children and Families, and I'm also part of Project Charge, as Peter had mentioned. I want to thank the conference organizers for inviting me to be here today to talk about this topic. This is something that our collaborative has been working on for the past 2 years, so it's really great to be able to share with you some of the work that we're doing. There is a couple of materials that are being passed around, and I'm not sure if we brought enough. So in case you didn't get one, please let me know, and I'm happy to forward that information to you. So there should be a PowerPoint presentation as well as a green report. So again, if you don't have it, just please let me know. So I have the honors task of going and giving a overview of some of the key benefits and challenges that, you know, we're facing with healthcare reform. So I'm going to try to do that as brief as possible, and you know, I welcome any questions that you might have at the end. So I thought I would begin my presentation with really just talking about, you know, why should we care about healthcare reform? Nationally, there's 47 million individuals who are uninsured. One in five have trouble paying medical bills. And, you know, I think this goes without saying, whether you're insured or uninsured, the cost of healthcare has been rising. And although, you know, many Americans like to say that we have the best care, healthcare in the world, we do spend the most when you look at other industrialized countries. Yet we have to also acknowledge that health disparities do exist for many of our communities, Asian Americans included. And bringing it home to New York State, from 2000 to about 2008, we saw a 97% increase of premiums. So again, you know, even those folks who have health insurance, we are continuing to struggle with being able to afford it. And, you know, back to the cost issue, 60% of all bankruptcies were a result of medical debt. And, you know, considering that we've been struggling with this economic downturn, health continues to be a top economic concern in many American families. So in terms of looking at how healthcare and healthcare reform is impacting Asian Americans, nationally there are about 2.3 million Asian Americans who are uninsured, and we find the highest rates being among the Koreans, Vietnamese, and South Asians. And so I wanted to pose a question out to the audience. Why do you think these three particular groups have the highest rates of uninsurance nationally? Any guesses? Okay. Sure. Right. Yeah. So many of these communities, it's the industries that they work in. I think someone also mentioned immigration status can also certainly impact that. When we look at New York City, one in eight Asian Americans is uninsured, but I think the takeaway here is when you actually look at who's uninsured, more often than not, they are those who are immigrants, so those that are foreign-born, 83%. And as was mentioned from the audience member, that, you know, while 65% of Asian Americans get health care through their employers, we do have to recognize there's a significant portion of those that are working in certain industries. So they're either small business owners, they work in cash-based industries like domestic work, or they're restaurant workers, or they're taxi cab drivers, and those tend to be industries that don't offer health insurance. And, you know, while we're looking at health insurance as one way to ensure access, access shouldn't just end at coverage. In the Asian American community, healthcare issues are compounded for a number of reasons, and as somebody had mentioned, it could be impacted by immigration status, language barriers, cultural stigmas regarding accessing public benefits, even if they are eligible, and as well as low utilization of primary and preventive services. And again, here is just a chart that breaks it down by some specific ethnic groups in the Asian American community. And what I thought I would do right now is also just give you some basic demographics of the Asian American community in New York City. And I want you to keep all of these demographics and these statistics in mind when you consider what made it into the final legislation and what didn't, and how it's going to be impacting the Asian American community.